Suppose you're given an infinitely differentiable function f of x and are tasked to make another function p of x that is an approximation of f of x at around some point, say x is equal to negative 1.1. How would you go about doing this? Let's start by trying to answer a simpler version of the problem. We will try to find the approximating function p of x around x is equal to 0. One key realization is that if p of x is equivalent to f of x around x is equal to 0, then their derivatives should also be equivalent around that region. This is also the case for the derivative of the derivative. And in general, this will continue for a while. That is, the nth derivative of p of x will be equivalent to the nth derivative of f of x around our region. So using this idea, we can start making our approximating function p of x. For example, say we let the third derivative of p of x equal to the third derivative of f of x at x is equal to 0. Next, consider the error function for this derivative set. That is the difference between the actual function and our approximation. As x approaches 0, the error function also approaches 0, which implies that for values near x is equal to 0, the third derivative of p is equivalent to the third derivative of f. This means that the area under their graph, or their integral, around this point will also be equivalent. The green colored region represents their overlapping area. It also gets more accurate to their actual areas as x approaches 0. From the fundamental theorem of calculus, we know that integrals are basically inverses of derivatives. Thus, the integral of the third derivative of p is second derivative of p plus c. So, the integral of the expression third derivative of p equal to third derivative of f at 0 is second derivative of p is equal to third derivative of f at 0 times x plus c, where c is some constant. Applying our idea of our functions having equivalent nth derivative again, this second derivative should now be equivalent to the second derivative of f. We have a freedom of choice with the plus c. In order to make the second derivative of p of x as similar to the second derivative of f of x around x is equal to 0, we set c equal to the second derivative of f at 0. This ensures that the error function approaches 0, which means they are equivalent in the neighborhood, and so are their integrals. Taking the integral again, we get the first derivative of p is equal to the third derivative of f at 0 times x squared divided by 2 plus the second derivative of f at 0 times x plus c. We set c is equal to the first derivative of f at 0, following the same reasoning as before. Repeating all of this for one last time, we get p of x is equal to the third derivative of f at 0 times x cubed divided by 3 factorial plus the second derivative of f at 0 times x squared divided by 2, or you can say 2 factorial, plus the first derivative of f at 0 times x plus c. Setting c to f of 0, we are finished with the construction of our approximating function p of x. And that is a pretty good approximation. But why did all of this even work? Well, we started by setting the third derivative of p to the third derivative of f. This told us the rate at which the second derivative of f was changing, and thus we made the second derivative of p respect that change. Hence, its approximation of the second derivative of f is more accurate. So when we took its integral, we got a better or more accurate value than if we had not started with the third derivative of f. Therefore, this means that even the next integral would be more accurate, and so on. In general, we are essentially starting from the nth derivative of f of x to make a good approximation for n minus 1 derivative of f of x as we get information about its rate of change, Now from this approximation, we can thus make further better approximation for n-2 derivative, because we get its rate of change information from our accurate n-1 derivative approximation, and so on due to the same logic. Therefore, all of its derivatives are approximated more accurately, and the overall approximation of f of x thus gets better for the larger nth derivative we choose to start from. To find the Taylor series centered at any point x is equal to a, we can shift the function's graph such that the value of x is equal to a is now at the origin point. Then we can take the Taylor series normally, but we plug in value a instead of 0. After that, we shift both functions back. So in general, this is the formula for the Taylor series of a function centered at x is equal to a. For most functions, as n approaches infinity, p of x will converge exactly into that function. There are some functions such as natural log of x who only have a finite radius of curvature for their Taylor series. This is because you can say that its derivatives simply do not carry enough information for Taylor series to continue converging after a certain bound. But other than that, Taylor series are some of the most powerful approximation tools available to us. They are used in essentially all STEM-related fields to get very accurate approximations. Thank you for watching. I hope you found this video helpful.